I don't know what's happening out here on the open range. Oh, yeah.
Hello, I'm Dr. Kate Watson, an anatomic pathologist for the California Animal Health and Food Safety Laboratory, here to teach you about doing a calf necropsy in the field today.
Some simple tools are useful for a necropsy. A sharp knife, a razor blade, scissors, and tweezers you probably already have at home. Pruners can be very useful for cutting ribs to expose the heart and lungs. Items you might not have at home, such as syringes, red top tubes for blood, and needles, you can get from your local vet, a vet supply store, or even Amazon.
Start with the animal lying on its left side. The first thing in any necropsy is to do a complete examination of the outside of the calf before opening it up, just as you would examine a live animal. Confirm and record the animal's identification by checking ear tags, tattoos, or hot brands. If you submit tissues to the diagnostic lab, it is best to include an ear tag in the shipment so that the pathologist can confirm that the submitted tissues are from the indicated animal. Next, check the eyes for any lesions. You may see redness or engorged vessels in the white part of the eye. This is called conjunctivitis. In some cases, you may see open sores or ulcers with or without associated redness in the eye. Check out the picture in the upper right corner. This is an example of a dermoid, a mass composed of skin-like tissue on the eye that can cause irritation and ulcers. While you are examining the head, check the nose for any discharge that might indicate respiratory disease. Check the oral cavity, including the tongue, gums, and roof of the mouth, for anything that looks abnormal, including redness, ulcers, blisters, masses, or even bad teeth. Check the roof of the mouth for a cleft palate. An often overlooked part of the necropsy is examination of the hooves, which can be a significant source of lameness. Check between the toes and along the coronary bands for any defects, masses, pus, ulcers, or blisters. Note if there is a lot of fecal staining from diarrhea or prolapsed rectum. Examine the umbilicus for any discharge, such as pus or urine. Feel the tissue surrounding the umbilicus for any swellings. After your external examination is complete, you open the animal to view the internal organs. Start by lifting up the right front leg. Stab into the space between the chest and the shoulder blade, working back the arm until it can lay flat. This is a good opportunity to collect blood in case the lab needs to run any serologic tests. Use red top tubes to store the blood. Next, reflect the right hind limb by making a similar cut into the groin or inguinal region near the hip joint. Cut through the joint capsule and surrounding muscles until the leg can lie over the back of the carcass. Next, we are going to connect our two cuts. Preserve the sharpness of your knife by not running your blade along the skin, but rather cutting underneath the skin as I am showing here. Reflect back the hide so that you have a good view of the abdominal cavity as well as the chest cavity. To prevent puncturing any abdominal organs while entering the abdominal cavity, I recommend either pinching the muscles and pulling upwards to make a stab incision, or lightly drawing your blade across the muscles until you reach the thin, white abdominal lining called the peritoneum. Once through the peritoneum, you can insert your knife and push down on the abdominal organs with the butt of the knife to help reflect back the muscle layers without puncturing any viscera. The diaphragm separates the chest and abdominal cavities. When viewing it from the abdominal side, it curves inward towards the chest cavity due to the negative pressure in the chest that allows our lungs to draw breath. Puncturing the diaphragm should draw air into the chest cavity so that it will start to relax and move closer toward the abdominal organs. If this doesn't happen, you may have a diaphragmatic hernia, air around or outside the lung, called pneumothorax, or fluid buildup, called pleural effusion. To remove the ribs, you should first cut through the muscles along the junction at the spine and along the sternum. Safely store your knife in a muscle belly while you use the pruning shears to remove half of the rib cage. Now that the rib cage is removed and the abdominal cavity is open, this is an excellent time to get a good look at all of the organs. You can visualize the lungs, heart, gastrointestinal tract, liver, and right kidney. The omentum is typically lying over the top of the intestines. Next, we are going to extend our cut all the way to the end of the lower jaw. You can see we are uncovering the windpipe or trachea, as well as the thyroid glands. Now we are going to remove the pleque by running our blade along the lower jawbone on both sides. This allows us to reach into the mouth and pull out the tongue. To do this, you need to cut through the soft tissue that anchors the tongue to the bottom of the mouth. In order to continue to remove the plaque, you need to cut through the cartilaginous connections between the bones that suspend the tongue and larynx, called the hyoid apparatus, on either side of the larynx. You can see the thymus here in the calf, which will not be present in an adult cow. Continue to remove the plaque so you can evaluate the left side of the lungs for any abnormalities, like adhesions in the form of white tissue strands covering the lung, or consolidation, which is reddish pockets of dense abnormal lung tissue. Here is the remaining part of the thymus that is inside the chest cavity. Within the pericardial sac, we have the heart. As you are examining the lung, make bread loaf slices into the tissue so that you can evaluate the large and small airways throughout. If you find abnormal lung as shown in the picture, take samples at the transition region between normal and abnormal lung. Next, we will be opening the trachea and esophagus to look for ulcers, erosions, or obstructions. The thinner, softer tube is the esophagus. It is good to look for a bloat line in the esophagus, as shown in the upper image. To open the esophagus, you can use scissors, although this can be challenging if they aren't super sharp, or your knife. Look at the inside of the trachea and check for abnormalities going all the way down to the bronchi. A small amount of foam or watery red fluid is normal. Make bread loaf slices into the tongue to check for any abscesses. Now we will look at the liver. Make cut sections through the liver, then leaf through the sections to check for abscesses, flukes, or unhealthy tissue that may not be visible from the surface. You can remove the liver at this time by putting tension along the diaphragm to expose and cut through the confluence of hepatic veins as well as the surrounding ligamentous attachments. Here's the adrenal gland. You know it's an adrenal gland by the heart or triangular shape. On cut section, you see the cortex surrounding the inner medulla. The entire adrenal gland can be submitted. Sitting here towards the spine is the right kidney, which you can remove with the fat. Cut through it lengthwise to evaluate the inside. Notice how the bovine kidney does not lose its fetal lobulation. From this view, you can see the abomasum leading into the pyloric region, heading into the duodenum, and going into the jejunum. The duodenum and jejunum are 2 out of 3 segments of the small intestine. Notice that this animal has some prominent lymphatics that may be secondary to fat uptake from nursing. The jejunum is the longest portion of the intestines, including all of these loops. The jejunum leads into the ileum. The ileum has mesentery on each side, which is the tissue keeping the intestines in place. The next portion is the cecum, which is a blind-ended sac. Here you see the ileocecal junction. If you flip that over, you can see the spiral colon, which is a little bit gas dilated here. Here we have the 4 stomachs, consisting of the abomasum, the omasum, the reticulum, and the rumen. The rumen in a nursing calf is small and the abomasum large. Tucked back behind here, we have the spleen. This is an organ that's also good to make multiple cut sections through to evaluate for any abnormalities. This is also a good time to evaluate the bladder. Here you see the remnants of the umbilical arteries, which start to fibrose down once the calf is born, and the uracus, another structure that goes away after birth. This calf's bladder is empty, but if there is urine, take a sample with a syringe and transfer it into a red top tube. Behind the bladder is the small uterus and ovaries in this female calf. Examine the umbilicus for any discharge, such as pus or urine. Feel the tissue surrounding the umbilicus for any swellings. White muscle disease is common in calves with selenium and vitamin E deficiency. Taking a muscle sample as well as a sample of the liver can help with that diagnosis. You want to send in a thin section of muscle like this. To remove the head, rock the head up and down to feel for the joint between the head and neck, called the occipito-atlanto joint. Make a cut into the joint with the point of your knife while extending the jaw away from the neck. Cut through the brainstem, muscles, and tendons connecting the head to the neck. If your progress is impeded by a bony process in the joint, this likely means you are not between the head and neck, but between the first two vertebrae, called the atlas and axis. Open the joints to check for infections. The joint fluid should be clear and slightly sticky. A large amount of watery or cloudy fluid indicates a problem. The inner lining of the joint should not be red. Submit abnormal tissues to a diagnostic lab for culture and histology. With the hip joint open, you can note any abnormalities in joint fluid, ligaments, capsule, articular surfaces, and underlying bone. When collecting samples to submit to your diagnostic laboratory, put all of the individual tissues into separate plastic bags to avoid cross-contamination. This is as simple as having individual Ziploc or specimen bags. Another common field practice is to use a clean rectal palpation sleeve. For this technique, make sure to tie off between the individual tissues to keep them separated. For example, here we have the spleen. This is a normal-looking spleen, but if you found an abscess, you would want to send that in for culture. Isolate the segment of interest and cut off at least a fist-sized section to send in for culture and histopathology. Go ahead and put that into the rectal sleeve. Make a knot to segregate the tissue. Then you are ready for the next sample. When examining the kidney, you can place your hand flat on top, draw your blade across the center, and then open it up to look for abscesses or discolored tissue. Take a fist-sized sample, add it to your rectal sleeve, and tie off for the next section. Here's the adrenal gland. You know it's an adrenal gland by the heart or triangular shape. On cut section, you see the cortex surrounding the inner medulla. The entire adrenal gland can be submitted. Next is the liver. As mentioned before, it is always good to cut bread loaf sections and look through them for any abnormalities that may not show up on the surface. Take a fist-sized piece of any affected area, including the capsular surface. Put it into the rectal sleeve and tie off. I recommend putting all of the intestinal samples into a separate sleeve, or you may get contamination with coliform bacteria that are normally found in the intestinal tract.
I hope you enjoyed this short video on how to perform a field necropsy. Remember, if you have any questions about sample collection, don't hesitate to reach out to your local diagnostic lab or veterinarian. If you're here in California, we are always available here at the California Animal Health and Food Safety Laboratory to assist you with questions you might have.
I don't know.